Balcones' first ever year-round bourbon was an inspiration. It all had to work together. A blend of carefully selected ingredients, Texas-sized pot stills, and creative people determined to find the absolute best way to usher a new whiskey along. When you discover how it pairs with a meaningful moment, suddenly the feeling of drinking great whiskey becomes a whole lot more.
This week, we sit down with Martin Riza, the first ever water sommelier. He doesn't sales pitch you on anything. He's not trying to sell you anything. The Houston Whiskey Social over here, we use spring water, not distilled water, for guests at the event, because spring water will help keep you from dehydration. It'll do a better job of taking care of your body than distilled water when you're drinking whiskey in a marathon-like event. So I sat down with Martin Riza. He's also, for those of you who are Your Mom's House fans, Tom Segura, Christina Pajitsky, huge fans, he is the water champ. He's a mommy, he's a fan of the show, and you thought I loved Coleman. Me and producer Jack sat down with Martin for 6 hours. 6 hours. Now, we recorded for an hour and a half, but we basically go through different mineral waters. We talk about the five worst waters you could drink. We talk about, we left feeling very, very much hydrated on the knowledge of water. A lot of it I already knew. I knew a lot going in. Trust me, I'm very smart. I'm the smartest man you know. As you guys know, sponsors of the show, Balcones, and of course, Amroot. Amroot is one of the most award-winning single malts and Indian single malts in the world. Huge fans. I love them dearly. I really could not be a bigger supporter of them. If you love, love, love good whiskey, if you're a Scotch person, go check out Amroot. It is something that has been, they've been a long time supporter of the show. I think we're actually coming up on a full year of support from them. And of course, the love is aimed right back at them. And of course, our friends over at Balcones. I absolutely adore Balcones. We got to sit down with Martin and taste him on our actual selection of Rumble Cask Reserve with Balcones. And it went swimmingly well. So yeah, without further ado, the first ever water sommelier in the U.S., and by the way, there's several dozen of them now around the world. This guy was a trendsetter. You can check him out in Zac Efron's Netflix show Down to Earth, episode 2. He did an episode on water. It is my extreme pleasure to introduce you, if you do not know who he is, to Martin Riza. Cheers. I've been following you for some time. I'm a big, big Martin fan. So
thank
I'm excited
you so
to sit
much.
Down. Thanks for coming on the show.
No, definitely, definitely. I'm a water sommelier, but a lot of people always think like, oh, so you're just drinking water? You think, not really. It's mm-hmm. like, I like wine. I have to say, I'm not into spirits so much. And I will tell you why at one point. But I love wine. I love champagne. I love sparkling wines. I'm like a huge fan of that. And I love beer, obviously, too. I'm German. I have to
It's a requirement.
Yeah, it's a requirement. When I don't like beer, I'm not allowed to go back to my home country, I think. So therefore, I love beer, too.
You've talked about this, and I'll let you talk more about it. But for those who don't know, smart water, all these distilled waters with nothing in them are actually hurting you.
I don't want to say hurt. I don't want to be that drastic. I don't like anything what is purified for two reasons. I'm a sommelier and I think it's amazing what nature can create. I think this is the same with spirit, the same idea that Mother Nature plays a huge role in spirits. The same obviously with wine. By wine, we have the term terroir. Everybody knows that term, that you can actually taste the differences from the region where the Riesling or the Chardonnay or whatever the grape is coming from. Water is 100% terroir driven. Because all these waters, what I have here in front of me and all waters, what I promote on my water menus, coming actually from the same source. It's rainwater at one point. It's a water cycle on this planet.
Sure.
So that rain drips down on the different layers around the world and the different soils have different terroirs. So some areas have tons of calcium dissolved. Some areas have tons of magnesium dissolved. So for me as a sommelier, I'm fascinated by the different taste profiles of real water, what comes from nature and is untreated. That's the whole point why I love the beauty of different waters. By purified water, on the other hand, that is nothing else than actually municipal sourced water. So it's your tap, from home.
That's already been processed. And
it's already been processed. A lot of energy was already been put in there. Then they're processing it again because they are diluting everything out of there. So no more minerals, everything what actually your body wants, like calcium, magnesium, potassium, silica, all these amazing minerals. That's the reason you're eating food, you're hungry. That's the reason you want to drink, because your body signalizes you at one point, I need more minerals. So you're drinking this highly processed beverage. I'm not even calling it water anymore these days. It's a highly processed beverage. And companies, big companies mostly, making tons of money on you by selling you filtered tap water. And I'm not into that. It's like, I think it's a scam for me. It's for me the biggest scam on planet Earth to buy for $2 filtered tap water in a plastic bottle. That drives me nuts. And then all this amazing stuff, what they're saying, overhydrating. My water is overhydrating you. My water is smarter than other waters. Come on, please, guys. Huh? It's like, really? It's H2O. And yeah. I'm saying this as a water sommelier. You know, it's. I don't want to say it's just water, because I strongly believe water is not just water. That's kind of like my hashtag where I'm living to. But why I should buy from a big corporation a highly processed tap water in a plastic bottle? There's no meaning to it. There's nothing to discover for me where I'm getting excited to. And the TDS levels, and it stands for total dissolved solid, so how many minerals actually combine in that water, are quite the same on all these purified water brands. They are between 5 to maybe 20, 30 TDS. There's nothing really exciting to me.
Yeah, and Fiji's under 40, 50 somewhere?
No, Fiji is actually 222.
Oh, wow.
Fiji is a natural occurring artesian water from the Fiji Islands.
Always been a big fan of Fiji. I know we've got a few people I work with, this girl Rayuri, who can't stand the taste because all she's used to drinking is distilled water that has nothing. And I think I'm a huge fan of mineral water. And like you said, so distilled waters will actually pull minerals from your body. If you are at a distilled spirits festival and you're drinking a ton of spirits, you're peeing 7, 8, 9 times that night. Not unheard.
Been
of.
There, done that.
Yeah. you're just flushing all that out, and of course dehydration leads to hangover.
Yeah, and you don't replenish the mineral content what you actually want. So it's not dangerous to drink distilled water when you're doing it like once or twice, but when you would do this like for 10 years, like the World Health Organization is saying, so over a long time of period when you would just drink distilled water now as your only water source, that might be not the best idea for your body. So please be careful what you're doing. And it's very funny. Cultural differences between Europe and America. So I'm obviously European. Everybody can, I think when I'm saying hello, everybody knows I'm German. what is totally fine. And yes, I live in Hollywood, so I'm not an actor. I'm not playing the role as a German guy. My accent is a real accent. I am from Germany. And when you're trying to buy distilled water in Germany, first of all, you cannot buy that in the grocery store. You have to go to the pharmacy for that. And the pharmacist will ask you, so what do you want to do with that? And when you're telling them, I want to drink that and I want to have 1 or 2 gallons, they will not sell you that. They will deny it. You think, no, you should not drink that. That's not for human consumption. This is for your lab. That's for a car battery. This is like where distilled water is actually created
for. Clean, for clean sanitary use.
Correct, for small appliances. But it's not for your body. Here in America, somehow lost in translation, people thought the idea of water should be pure.
Sure.
Huh? So therefore, this word purified water is very misleading to me. Because I'm saying when water is pure, don't drink it. Because when there's nothing in there anymore, it's kind of like a carrot boiled for thousands of hours. We all know that carrot is dead. There's nothing nutritious anymore on that carrot. It's for me the same with highly processed, purified or distilled water. There's not really benefits to my body. Why should I drink it? Because there's no minerals dissolved. And in Europe, it's like we don't even have purified water companies. Doesn't exist. In Germany, not even one brand. There's actually one brand owned by Coca-Cola. And they have it on their like guns. The same what you have it here. But in the grocery store, you will not find any purified water companies. Doesn't exist. Everybody knows mineral content of water.
And you coming from Germany, that's actually where you got your certification at, correct?
Yeah. So I'm from the Danish border up north. And that might be the reason I started to love water already for that reason, because the North and Baltic Sea is right in front of me. It's like the state is called Schleswig-Holstein. It's the most northern part state of Germany, where then it the border of Denmark and Germany, guys up there. When you see the map of Germany, you will see like Germany is surrounded by all this amazing, beautiful, crazy countries in Europe. But up north, it's just the Baltic Sea and the North Sea, and then you have Denmark above that. So that little part, Schleswig-Holstein, the diameter of that is maybe 30 miles. And you have two big seas. So I'm directly from that border, from the two seas. So I've been always been exposed to water, a lot of water always in my eyes. What I already appreciate, and let's face it, I think we humans, we are coming from water. We all know that. We are here at Petit Hermitage Hotel. Everybody loves to lay at the pool right now, but they are facing the pool. Nobody would come with an idea up to face not the pool. And when you're going to the beach, everybody is facing the beach, the water, and nobody would face the other way around. Maybe when there's a beautiful girl right behind you. But sure, that's pretty much all why you might be would turn your head. But everybody always faces to water. So somehow I think it's a thing for us in general that we love and we are attached to water still, even when we're not born in water.
You've got me thirsty. So let's jump into this. You've got in front of you, 12 bottles of water, give or take.
Yeah.
How much water do you think you drink a day?
I stopped counting at one point because it doesn't make sense for me anymore to think about it. But the question is always funny because I'm getting the same question, like your question, in the first like 5 minutes. It's like, so how much water are you drinking, Martin? And when you would ask a wine sommelier, so how much wine are you drinking on a daily basis? Nobody would really think like he would drink like 3 or 4 or 5 gallons of wine.
Sure.
Yes, there are videos out there where I actually spitting water. Because when I have there's a big video of National Geographic where they followed me to China to a big water tasting competition. And I had to taste 120 different mineral waters in a short time of period of like an hour.
So you spit it all out.
So I have to spit it out because first of all, I don't want to go to the restroom all the time because even a water sommelier needs to go and pee at one point. And second, like your body signalizes you, I don't want to see water anymore. And my palate wants to be engaged and I want to be very like always eager to taste water. So I'm trying to dehydrate myself all the time. But when I know I have a big tasting coming up, I drink on purpose, not so much water right beforehand that my body is really eager to taste the water and wants to discover everything out of the water. But to your question, I would say between 2 and 3 gallons per day. I like to drink a lot. When I don't do tastings, I start with my first half gallon before I'm even going up to like really engage with myself to society. Like between my bed and the shower, I have my first half gallon in. Especially important in the morning to drink a lot of water because your body will really start all the engines when you're putting a lot of water to yourself. By this being said, you can drink even too much water as well. So don't do the mistake to say, oh, I'm putting my 3 or 4 gallons per water intake as well at 8 p.m. in the night. And then the whole day you don't drink. That's not healthy for your body. Your body needs all the time liquids to function properly. So please don't do the mistake to think you can starve yourself for quite a while and then drink a lot because you can actually die on that too.
Hyperhidrosis.
Correct. So when you're drinking around 6-7 liters in an hour, short time of period, there are chances that you can actually pass. And that happened in 2000, I think 6 or 7 here in California in Sacramento from a radio station. They thought it's a great idea to bring people into the studio and say, so how much water can you drink in 1 hour? Without going to the restroom.
It was a woman, right?
Yeah, it was a woman. And she passed, like, I think 3 or 4 hours later. Oof. And it's crazy. Therefore, so please give me the big favor. Don't overhydrate yourself, too, because that can go the wrong way.
Well, I tend to balance it out. So I have a gallon of water and then a gallon of whiskey. And
I like it. And yeah, it's a good mix.
Flush it out faster.
Correct. No. But, like, I think, like, steady drinking all the time, that's, like, the key here.
Sure. Okay, well, let's get cool. started. So okay. What did you bring with you? What did you want to start?
Now, so
I want to say I've definitely had Vichy Catalan. It's the most famous I think of, the Spanish water. So go ahead and I'll let you pick. And yeah.
So I don't know how we're doing this with spirits, but by wine tastings, you would start with we all know this. We will start with a light white wine and then going to heavy red wines.
The concept is the same in
spirits.
Yeah.
So for me, Vichy Catalan is kind of like a Bordeaux. It's like one of the highest mineral content water you can actually find. Here on the menu, it is the highest one. I brought something very special for you. It's Roy, so maybe you're already familiar with that because I brought this to the podcast of Your Mom's House podcast as well. And this was something where everybody's like, holy moly, what the hell is that water?
I remember the name. I don't. It's Russian or something?
Slovenian.
Same thing.
It's, oh my God, don't let the Slovenian people say that.
Just kidding, yeah.
No, but East European waters, what content? Mostly always very high mineral content. So the East European people love high mineral waters. It's really interesting as well. Here in America, a lot of people drinking water. Still waters mostly like low in TDS. In Germany, everybody loves like a medium TDS water, but carbonation has to be always bubbles in Germany. And the East European people, they love really intense high mineral waters.
I saw your Gwyneth Paltrow, your outrage video, where she was suggesting to mix Himalayan sea salt and in the water, when there's plenty of fantastic spring waters out there, ready to drink.
It's for me like the same concept of like, yes, buy yourself a purified water and then going right after to GNC and buy yourself little magnesium pills. It's like, just buy yourself a good real water from nature and you don't have to spend money on this magnesium pills. So that is the benefit of real water, that they're actually minerals dissolved and you don't flush out minerals.
Now, you, while you're pouring, I'll, so you, just so, and correct me if I'm wrong at any point here, but I believe you got your certification as a water sommelier in 2011. After releasing a book in 2010, you have been fighting the good fight in North America for quite some time as the only water sommelier. And of course, you introduced the first ever water menu in the States, I think in 2005, 2006, somewhere in there. So, oh, really?
So I created the first water menu in Germany in 2005. And then I came to the States in 2011 based on this O1 visa for extraordinary abilities on my knowledge of water, actually. So when I went to the embassy in Berlin back in the days, to the American embassy, and my lawyer from America said already like, okay, they will be all looking at you because first of all, they don't have so many O1 visa applicants. It's a very hard visa to get. Just 2% of all visas being issued are O1s. It's the hardest visa you can actually apply for this country. And with the smallest rate of actually achieving that.
And it's if you have a special ability that could benefit society here.
Correct.
In the US.
It's called the celebrity visa as well. It's for like scientific people. Like when I looked at the regulations, and I just have my high school diploma, so when my lawyer said like, yeah, Martin, you should do the O1, so I looked into it, and then when I saw the requirements, like when you're a scientist, like the Nobel Prize would be great. When you're like an actor, an Emmy or an Oscar would be great. And was like, hello, I'm high school diploma, so I don't have any like that.
Sure.
But he said like, no, what you're doing with water in Germany is quite fascinating, and this is really actually something so unique, and you're the top of your field. This is like what the requirements saying. You have to be on top of your profession to acquire this kind of visa. And it took me 6 months, over 400 pages petition, a lot of recommendation letters from very powerful people in America already to say, no, we need Martin here in America to really educate people on the benefits of real water. And I think here in America, we all know that a lot of people drinking, eating junk food, I think it's a huge benefit for everybody, and it's not my first time in America. I used to live already here in 2000, but I had a J1 visa, so a practic visa, something very simple, and I was not here for water. I was here for the restaurant business because I'm obviously working in restaurants. And back in the days when I went to the grocery store and I saw beer there, and I saw like, I don't want to even badmouth all these beer brands, but I saw like this beer, what Americans thought this is the taste of beer, I was almost insulted by the name you calling that beer. I would call it water. It's a water sommelier now.
Does that beer also have a German sounding name?
Maybe. So I was very like unimpressed, let's say like this. Now 20 years later, now we're saying 2020, I'm fascinated about all this amazing, incredible beers what you have here in America.
Oh, it's awesome, yeah.
And it's incredible, all these crafted ideas. And I think it's the same with spirit now. There's so much to discover in America. It's fascinating for me. And I really love to live now in America. I'm a huge fan of this country. I'm a huge fan of the different states, of the different cultures, of the different societies and feelings and the American spirit. Obviously, every country has its positive and negative sides. And we all know this here. And I don't want to go political right now, but we all know this country has some issues and we in Germany have some issues. Yeah. So there's nothing wrong about it. There's no best country on this planet, in my opinion, because the best country on this planet would be the country where I'm the only citizen.
Sure.
Then I can do whatever I want. So that would be the best scenario. But I think we as a society need to respect ourselves.
You bring up, and we definitely have, this is definitely not a political show, but you are a perfect example of the process that we as Americans struggle with most. And that is, you have someone that's come here to do something good.
And I want to do something good. Yeah.
To help educate people on water and to make a difference and to teach how very simple you can change your health.
Correct.
But we, and as you've been witness to and talked about a few times, we feel the need to push against you and feel like water sommelier, what is this? It sounds like garbage, right? It sounds like it's made up. It's a perfect example of someone, you're not trying to sell me on anything other than, hey, this is healthy.
Correct.
Just drink healthy. And people push, we fight. That's our struggle as Americans, is we always want to push against simple, sound medical advice.
It's very interesting what you're saying here, because like when I created my first water menu in 2012, it was at Race and Stark Bar at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. So I created that water menu because I strongly believe that every restaurant actually should have a selection of different waters because water has taste. And when I'm going to a sports bar, I expect at least 10 different beers on tap.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what I'm expecting. When I'm going to a nice cocktail place, I'm expecting that the bartenders know what they're doing and that they have some interesting scenarios of different spirits with them. So that's for me what I'm expecting. So why I should not expect the same with our most important beverage in our lives, without we wouldn't be even here and nothing else could actually be created, because all other spirits, all other alcohol, everything else is based on water. So why should I not get a selection over there too? And I'm a strong believer that I don't want to force anybody to buy a bottle. Here at Petit Hermitage and on all my other waters menus, actually the tap water is part of the water menu. So my current water menu here at Petit Hermitage, on I don't know which page that is, but it says it's alphabetically ordered by first the countries and then in alphabetic what the name of the water brand is. And there's then West Hollywood tap water. And it's been exactly the same like a bottled water, the history where this water actually comes from, what's actually dissolved, because this has a TDS level 2 tap water. And then the price is obviously zero because I don't believe in the concept of charging people for a human right. And that is water. So in a restaurant, I would never work in a restaurant where it's mandatory to charge even for tap water. And I know a lot of restaurants doing this these days because they're buying themselves a filtration system. And then they're doing exactly the same what I'm against to, selling you for $2 or $3 or $4 a carafe of nothing else what is filtered tap water. And I don't believe in this. I have a filtration system here at Petit Hermitage, but we don't charge anything for that. You can drink so many gallons you want for free. And that's my core belief as a water sommelier, that water is a human right and nobody should pay when they're going out for dinner for water. When you want to discover a little bit more exciting brands, I have a selection as well. Not everybody wants to drink filter tap because not everybody likes the taste of it. Therefore, I have a menu. That's the whole point behind that concept.
Right.
When I started the first water menu at Race and Stark Bar, the press was very positive. And we had 2 or 3 articles were very skeptic, and we still have this sometimes, and this is fine. I understand this. When you're creating something with a lot of passion, there will be always a pushback from other people. It was quite interesting. A lot of people told me, Martin, when you, because you created something with passion, and people will call you out on that and say that this is bullshit or this is not right what he's doing, that means you actually did something right because you created something what people maybe can talk about it. So that's actually a good thing. That people are not always agreeing with everything you're doing.
Sure. And you prefaced that when you first came in. You said we don't always have to agree on everything.
No, and we don't have to. And why we need to? I think this is the whole key of society, to live in a society, and we don't need to agree on everything, but we need to discuss it together as human beings. And that's the reason I think why we're advancing ourselves as a society all the time, because we will understand your problem, I will understand my problem. Let's figure it out together. and let's move on. And somehow right now with this...
with coronavirus.
It drives me nuts that we're going back to a political thing, because really we should talk about water things. But it's strange for me that there's just black and white right now in America. And this is not healthy for society in general.
Agreed.
I would love to see Republicans, Democrats a little bit more talking to each other.
I couldn't agree more. And normally when we do get a little political on the podcast, it's usually after we've had a few. You know, but it's all love. It's all like, I don't have any, I feel like the key, and this is the last thing I'll say, and then we'll move on to this. I feel like the key to our issues is going to be a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B. Like, it's not going to be black or white. We're going to have to meet somewhere in the middle on a few things.
I think so too. And it's way more fun to meet in the middle than to say like, no, I'm there and there. Anyhow, so we're starting today with a lore TDS water, so with like a white wine, with a light white wine. And this water comes from Iceland, Icelandic glacier. It's pretty famous suddenly now in America. They did a great job, obviously, marketing-wise to discover this water in Iceland for many, many years ago. But now you can get this pretty much everywhere here in America. I think it's a very tasty water in the beginning, so it's very easy to drink, easy to swallow. Tastes like water, what people would say. The first water to taste is always tough because it will taste like water.
It just tastes like water, yeah.
Yeah.
The word that comes to mind is boring, but not in a negative way. It seems like a very baseline water.
Correct. It's easy to drink. It's not like we will have later on waters where you would say like, okay, one glass and it's enough for me, Martin. I don't want to drink more than that. And I think that is an interesting factor about the differences in water, that some waters are very easy to drink and have a good mouthfeel, and some waters are really like heavy and strong, and you will see like, that might be interesting, but thank you so much, Martin, I will never do this again. And this is okay. I've been on the Conan O'Brien show like for 7 years ago, and we did a water tasting with Conan. And obviously it's a comedy show. Conan need to make fun of this sequence.
And he does, yeah.
And he does, and he needs to, and I like it. I love to talk to comedians because they are brilliant in their mindset. They're very fast. They can talk very, very easily. They can compensate a lot of information very fast. I'm a big fan of comedians in general. And obviously Conan was mocked me the whole time. And I was like, hey, I know, I'm just like scientific based facts what I'm just talking here. So therefore you can make fun so much you want.
Sure.
I can show you, I don't know how much books and literally what says black on white, what I just said. So it's totally fine with me and they can laugh about it. I can actually laugh about it. Like, let's face it. He's a water sommelier from Germany. It seems to be like from The Onion. I get it. And I even have fun with that.
Well, and just to cut you off there for a second, but that premise is not unheard of. There was recently announced a milk sommelier. And I don't know any legitimacy behind that, but similar European descent talking about how much he respects milk. And watching him, which by the way, to me is disgusting. I don't know of a single adult who drinks milk or loves it that much, but it's natural to give them a hard time about it. And I think there was also once a short-lived mustard sommelier, but
yeah.
You obviously have stood the test of time.
Yeah, I'm doing this since 15 years now. So I did my first Waterman in 2005. So it's not like, it's not only in LA, what a lot of people are always saying to me. It's like, oh, only in LA there's a water sommelier. Yeah, there are around 400 water sommeliers around the world now. So it's not only in LA.
Sure.
And I started that whole concept in Germany in 2005. So it was first a German thing maybe, and then I brought it over to the States. But anyhow, comedians and like what the camera doesn't show you, Conan, for example, said when the music was playing, like, Martin, this was great. I loved that whole concept. And like, I really enjoyed like how you take it so lighthearted as well. Yes, I was like pushing the envelope, but you were just smiling and having fun with that. And I think this is like the whole idea. It's like entertainment piece. It's not about that I'm going to a school and I'm like teaching now kids about the purposes of drinking water. Like, I always look for like what kind of concept that is. And the same with the Netflix show. It's not a scientific proven show where I'm like there as a person, as a teacher or something. I don't see myself as a teacher at all. I see more like self as, yes, I've as entertainer to create something, and I want to showcase the beauty of this amazing waters, what Mother Nature can give us actually. I want to give you a benefit. And this was the same on the Netflix show. Like I think we taped for 4 hours, the 7 minute piece. It's always like that. Like we're always taping and taping and taping, and we had way more water there than they actually showcased. And sometimes I was a little bit unhappy about how they're cutting it then. But it is what it is. In the end, I think the show pieces very well. I received tons of emails. Very positive emails. 99% extremely positive. The same on Twitter. What always like, it's for me like, Twitter's always like very interesting how they can go.
Sure.
But even on Twitter, everybody was like, oh my God, I didn't know there's a water summit. That is so cool. I learned so much from this little 7 minute piece. And that is like what I really love and enjoy. Like, I just want to help people. That's all what I want to do.
Yeah, I think it comes from the Dunning-Kruger effect, where people don't know what they don't know. And so their initial reaction is to push it, but you can physically taste the difference in these waters. And I know we've had one. Let's try another one.
And I think let's try something similar, because we had now Icelandic Glacier. And let's go with Fiji, actually. Here we go. So I brought two mezcals. It's called the Dos Perros, and one is the Joven, and the one is the five years in oak barrel. Obviously hold it. Dos Perros is an incredible good, our house brand of mezcals. Our owner, Stefan Ashkenazi, is part of this branding, and he loves Dos Perros. And I think it's an incredible good, small boutique mezcal, what you barely can find here in America. And I always love to showcase good products. And I thought like, I need to showcase obviously some incredible good Dos Perros to you as well. And we should taste this later.
Yeah, yeah.
I know, like I'm German and like, but like we're drinking alcohol 24 hours. So I would never think like, oh my God, it's just 2 p.m. here in Los Angeles right now. In German, it's already 9 hours later. It's 10:45 p.m. So you should be already like drinking a lot in Germany. So I need to get started anyhow.
I'm with you 100%. So. Yeah. The concept that it's like, you know, you're drinking before noon. No, of course. Like, why not?
I don't understand.
It's a weird religious thing that
I have no clue what that is.
Our country.
Like when people are saying like, oh, you should not drink before that or that hour, that doesn't make sense for me. Icelandic, you said almost like boring to it because it was so clean. It was, I think, very refreshing was Icelandic Glacier as well. Fiji has a little bit heavier mouthfeel.
I like to Fiji a lot.
It's a little bit thicker
on
the palate due to the mineral composition. It's higher already in the TDS levels. It's 222. It has a lot of silica in Fiji. That's a natural occurring mineral what's surrounded in the Pacific Rim areas. All the waters from the Pacific Rim areas have higher silica content. And Fiji obviously is from the Pacific Rim. And it is from Fiji. A lot of people always saying like it's just marketing. No. It's actually from Fiji. And the silica makes water very smooth, almost like velvety. What it's interesting to spirits, because it's not the first time that I'm actually drinking spirits and water in a combination. I did for 2 years ago, I was in Vegas with 50 bartenders. I was invited there from a very, very large vodka company. And they said, Martin, we would love to talk about water, the impact of water in cocktails. And is there anything even to discover? So we created ice cubes out of Vichy water, Fiji water, and Las Vegas tap water. And we told the bartenders, okay, so you're creating your cocktail. It's exactly the same measurements of the same, everything is the same. And you're just putting the different ice cube in the shaker. And you shake it. You put it into a glass to see if there's a difference. And literally every 50 bartender said in the beginning, no way you will see a difference, because with the acidic of the lemon, what's in there, with the spirit, the vodka, what's in there, plus all the other ingredients, then the seconds we're shaking that, it will not dilute so much. So we tasted that and they were all blown away how different their cocktail tasted just based on the ice cube they used.
Better or worse?
Obviously, Vegas tap was not really enjoyable because there's so many chemicals in there. And again, like I'm not actually a big fan of bad-mouthing tap water. Because first of all, we should be lucky that we kind of like have safe and clean drinking tap water in America. We all know what happened in Flint, Michigan for several years ago. And I think it's kind of pity that we consider America one of the leading countries on this planet. We cannot even give access to clean, safe drink water to all Americans. That's kind of like rubs me the wrong way too.
It's a real problem.
Yeah, that's a real problem. And when people think, oh, it would be too expensive to invest in water distribution, he's like, excuse me.
So every country does it.
Yeah, we have to do that. as a society. Like water is something so basic, and we all know that. And this is the I'm calling it the dark side of water, because the future of water will be very messy. And I'm saying this in a very serious thing now. I'm on a regular basis, I'm very lightheaded when it comes to water, and like I enjoy my job. But when I see the future of water and water rights been sold to big corporations in countries where like big corporations suddenly can tell you like, oh, you have to pay like X amount of bottled water if you, because we will stop the tap water qualities there and all this kind of stuff. Like
it's, Nestle did that too. Yeah, I think at one point
it's very dirty and very nasty, and I don't like this. And I'm not a guy who supports privatization of water rights. I think the water rights needs to be in government's hand. I don't like when governors been bought off by big corporations getting a lot of money to say like, oh, it's okay. Now it's like, it's safe to drink. Like this is pretty much what happened in Flint. It was safe to drink by regulations. Obviously it was poison. And then you can see it on Wikipedia, like really the timelines where the government still said, no, it's all okay. It's all safe. No, it was not safe. Clearly not safe. Yeah. It was not safe at all. It was by regulations safe. Because that chemical was dissolved in that. They didn't check for that. So by regulation it was safe to drink. So that doesn't mean even the regulations say it's safe to drink doesn't mean it's safe.
That means the regulations are wrong.
Correct. Yeah. So, yeah. And I think that's sometimes where a lot of people are getting confused. Yeah, but the government's saying it's safe to drink. The regulation says that. You think, yeah, great. But the regulation says they're checking, I think, for around 100 different chemicals these days in tap water. But we have over 4,000 known chemicals could be actually in tap water these days. They don't check for that.
Yeah, and I think some of the best tap water in the world is in France, right? It was that same episode, I think they talked about it, yeah.
They're doing, it's kind of like you have a lot of Scandinavian countries have incredible good tap waters. And it's, for me, it's a easy understandable idea is the more it rains, the better is the tap water. What makes kind of sense, because they have access to more and more water when it rains a lot in their countries versus like here in California where it barely rains, what is very, or very Vegas. Sad, obviously, or Vegas, clearly. Obviously, they have to put a lot of, let's chlorine in it to make it safe. And I get it. Like, they want to make sure no bacteria can, like, grow from that. So I totally understand why government regulations here in the city in Los Angeles, West Hollywood, or in Vegas, they have to chlorinate it really highly. Because they just want to make sure in this warm environment that nothing will be, like, in a bacteria standpoint.
Sure.
E. coli bacteria, all these kind of bacteria you can actually find in water will be definitely out. So I understand that concept. For me, in an epicurean idea, when it comes to tasting all these amazing brands, it hurt actually a spirit when you have fluoride or especially chlorine, like overpowering the beauty of a spirit, especially when it comes to vodka, because vodka is very subtle in flavors. It will hurt clearly and drastically.
Yeah, so a lot of distilleries will do is during the mashing process, like I know, especially at Westland, which is in Seattle, they throw a garden hose into the mash tun. So it's just tap water going in. Then when they distill it, distillation is purification. Mm-hmm. That's the old saying.
Correct.
In distillation. And then at the bottling line where they water it down, they'll add RO, mm-hmm. reverse osmosis mm-hmm. water. And that's supposed to be the purest, cleanest.
Yeah, it's and I understand because they don't want to do anything to it. So they want to make sure like their base product is what they think then already perfect. And they just want to dilute it with something very tasteless. I totally understand that. We just, I just been in the progress of another brand who actually will use water infused with minerals now in their end product. They will dilute it with additional minerals. Yeah. So like now after, I cannot say the company, they will launch it at one point. You will then right away know it. Oh my God. Yeah. Martin talked about it and I'm not allowed to actually expose any branding names right now and everything, but they have a really cool concept and they realize there is actually a taste differences when you're watering it down with water with minerals.
Right.
It will enhance actually something.
Make it better.
And it can make it better or actually worse.
Can you say if it's a new company or a company that's been around a while?
It's a traditional company.
Oh, okay.
And they're changing the whole concept.
Exciting.
Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. And I'm since a year I know about this project and I was tasting a lot of their product now. It's fascinating how different. I can smell the difference just by smelling it.
That's very interesting. I'm excited.
That the water, just the water is different. Everything else is exactly the same.
But do you know if it's going to be high TDS or just some with more in it? Okay. Can't say anything. All right. Well, what's next? What do we got next here? What are your thoughts on Ozarka? Spring water.
Totally fine water.
Yeah.
And for me, I'm always saying, like, and this is like a lot of people, like the second most biggest question I'm always getting, Martin, what is the best water?
I get that a lot with this. What's your favorite whiskey?
No best water, because everybody runs on a different palate. Because I think this is a great water. Like, I like Fiji water. I like all the brands I have here. I think they're all amazing and incredible. That does not mean you will like it. Because, for example, you maybe love Mezcal. I will say, I hate Mezcal. I love a German Riesling. It's just my palate, what runs on wine. And you
Is
love
that true,
spirits.
Though? You're not a big Mezcal fan?
No, in general. I mean, like, it's an example.
Sure. Yeah.
So why saying, like, this water is now the best? And I understand, I don't know how many posts already on Instagram to say there is no best water.
It's on your website, too.
Yeah. 2 days later, the question comes up again. So, Martin, what is the best water? You think, Jesus. It's like, just like, do I have to do it again? It's quite interesting, but I totally get it. And I think when I would be a person sitting somewhere, I'm scrolling through my Instagram account and suddenly this German guy shows up and it's all about water. And I'm realizing, I had this yesterday, for example, two guests came to me and said, like, Martin, you changed my life. We're drinking water since we're thinking about it, because they don't drink alcohol. So they were very excited to see a water menu suddenly. They didn't know who I am and that I have a water menu. They just saw it on the app. You think they have a water menu. So they started to drink 5 or 6 different mineral waters. Then they realized, oh my God, there's a water sommelier around here even. So I talked to them and they literally thanked me and said, you changed our lives. We never thought it could be so interesting. We just bought brand A, B, and C.
It has to do with our education here on the subject. We just don't talk about it.
Correct.
We talk about water's important. We say hydration's important.
Oh, yeah.
It's not an everyday thing.
Yeah. And this is, for me, as a water sommelier, it's just fun to discover this, that people really starting to react suddenly on it and saying, like, oh my God, Martin, I didn't know that there's actually so much to discover. And it's not just about the taste of waters who are differently. It's literally about the pairing compatibility as well about these waters. That you can actually, your spirit will taste better when you have the right water in front of you. Or your wine can taste better or even worse when you have the right or the wrong water to it. So the idea of the concept of, and we all know this concept of, so water should neutralize your palate. Everybody says this in the wine tasting. For me, I have no clue who came up with that idea. For me, whoever created that idea is an idiot. Because let's face it, I'm going to the restaurant. I'm selecting an incredible good bottle of red or white wine. It costs me a fortune sometimes in restaurants, like maybe $300, $400, $500 even for a bottle of wine. And then I should drink a water that would neutralize the taste flavor of that wine. So I just drink the wine, then I will neutralize it with the water and the taste is gone. What kind of stupid concept is that? No, I want to find a water who will help the wine to grow in my palate. And there are some waters who actually can do that. They really enhance the flavors of the wine, and the wine flavor is still in your palate even after you drank a good amount of glass of water after that.
So as sensitive as your palate is, how are you with spirits? Is it intense?
And that is exactly why I'm not a big spirit fan. I don't drink any cocktails. I don't barely drink any spirits. I used to drink gin, like for many, many years ago.
Yeah.
Like for 20, 25 years ago. I liked gin. I liked vodka too.
It's very aggressive, huh?
Yeah.
For you?
But now these days, because I'm so concentrating about flavors and to detect flavors out of any beverages, pretty much, I can't drink so much spirits anymore, because it really is, it's almost like somebody's hitting me in my face.
Okay.
So
can I test you on something?
I would love to discover you a little bit.
Okay,
something,
sure.
But I'm not a spirit person.
So
I don't know how long now I haven't drank any spirits anymore.
I love this. So I had this thought about you before, because you have to have such a sensitive palate to be able to really, not all of them, some of them are drastic. I mean, you taste Vichy compared to what we normally taste. You're going to taste it. Crazy water. You really do taste the difference.
Oh, yeah.
Even with a mediocre palate or a young palate. Spirits, especially high proof spirits, in this hobby, the tradition is this. You start drinking with, your dad's beer at 18, 19 years old. What's the legal age in Germany? 18?
Huh. No. Way younger.
Younger?
16? So we have this in two steps, or actually three steps. When you're a child and you're sitting in a restroom with your parents, it's totally fine. It's not like I'm not allowed to serve you a beer or something like this.
That's
but
legal
you can,
in Texas.
But too. You can nip it. You can like, it's totally fine to like have a child with the parents and to like just taste it, like for tasting purposes.
Sure.
There's no age restrictions pretty much on that. Then when you're turning 16, you're allowed to purchase alcohol as well, but just, we're calling it soft alcohol, wine and beer. And when you're turning 18, then you can actually purchase spirits.
Interesting.
So it's in two, or it's in three steps. And I love the logic behind that. Because the idea is to slowly give the younger generation the ability to showcase that alcohol can be something very beautiful, or the other way around,
agreed,
can be extremely harmful to you.
Yeah.
So that's the concept. And it's not about, oh my God, no alcohol. No, this is crazy. And then when you're turning 21, suddenly you're like, holy fuck, I can do whatever I want now. Let's go. Huh? Obviously, we all know nobody will do this 21 thing. Huh?
That's the problem with our current culture is we want to hit it hard. And we're big on shots, which I think is so dangerous. But I've got something I want to taste, John.
Okay,
so
cool.
You've got the beer, then you eventually may do a Jack and Coke. You like to mix cocktails. Then you may drink a Jack and an ice cube with some water, you know. Then you go just Jack and maybe a little few drops of water to kind of cut the proof. Then you're drinking it neat at 80 proof. This, you know, a lot of them are already pre-cut down. This hobby, though, is big on pushing the limits of what your palate can handle. And proof, we love big, bold, cash strength, 61% alcohol, which is great if you can learn to drink correctly. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit more delicate. You've got to learn how to drink,
sure,
in order to not let it overwhelm you. So
I'm gonna
pour you something, and I think it would be best in this, in the glass.
Great. Yeah, perfect. Yeah, yeah, great.
So because this is gonna, loving the smell of water, loving the smell of this experience, I think you could really benefit from something like this.
Cool.
This is called Balcony's Rumble Cask Reserve. Stand by.
I brought actually a water as well. It's called the Spicy Glenlivet water. And when you think Glenlivet, look, wait a minute. I know Glenlivet. That's something from Scotland. So that is actually the water, or like almost like the brewing water quality, what they're using in Scotland. So this is the same company, Spicy Glenlivet. And this is the water, what obviously is then the perfect scenario for watering,
sure,
down your whiskeys. So that's pretty cool.
Perfectly still water. They sell that at Specs here. And I will tell people real quick before you taste it, Aqua Maestro, mm-hmm, is a great website that you, yeah, can order all these waters from. And yeah, in Texas, we are limited on what we can get, but you can get the Speyside Glenlivet at Specs. It's like our K&L. It's a big chain spirits liquor store. So this is Rumble Cask Reserve. It's not whiskey. It's not rum, it's not brandy, but it's a little bit of everything. It's made from Mission Figs.
Interesting.
Turbinado sugar and honey. So
I think, like, because the first thing what came into my mind, I love the color. I think this amazing, beautiful, like Bernstein golden color is, I think, for me, incredible. I love to look actually first at my beverages. And now people would say, as a water swimmer, you like to look at your beverages? Come on, Martin, please. There's nothing to see. Trust me, there's a lot of sea in water already.
Sure.
So when you put what I'm doing in tastings, I have a white piece of paper mostly underneath my glass, and I'm looking actually under the white piece of paper, because when I'm looking right now here at Petit Hermitage into this glass, there's so many other colors obviously interfering with the color of the spirit. And the same with water. Water is kind of like a mirror reflector of other colors. So when I have something just based white, I can actually see the nuances in water, and you can especially see obviously carbonation levels already in water just by looking at the glass and to see it in the glass. So I love always to look first into my glass. Then the same what I would do, like as a wine sommelier, I love to pull a nose. I'm always afraid, like especially when it comes to spirit, to put my nose right away fully in there, because my nose again is very sensitive to all
it
odors.
Burns, yeah,
and then it will burn completely. So I always have my nose a little bit like but starting to think. But I think like I'm picking up right away like this beautiful honey caramel notes.
Yeah.
What I think is incredible.
So this one in particular actually spent its entire life in an ex Oloroso sherry barrel. Are you a fan of Madeiras and ports and fortified wines? This is why I love this spirit. And so I thought, now it's intense, it's a lot. So what I would tell people to do, I know you pour a couple ounces of water, you tend to bring the whole thing in. I would take infinitely smaller sips and keep it in the front of your mouth until your mouth can adjust to the burn. It's very similar in tasting water, except you've got to, your body's got to recalibrate to remove the burn of the alcohol.
Sure, makes sense.
So that you can get to the bottom of it.
I have one water here later on, and you said like, okay, and Martin, you're always putting a lot of water into your glass and then you drink it. And this is obviously what I'm always saying to people as well. When you're tasting water, put a lot of water first in your palate, drink it, and then do another sip and drink it again and put it a little bit more on your palate that your palate can understand the flavor of that. And don't chill actually water down. Temperature is a huge factor when it comes to water tasting.
It chokes it. It's the same with spirits. Yeah, it'll literally suffocate.
Correct.
And restrict it.
Yeah. So don't chill your products, please, down when you're doing it on a professional basis. And obviously never, ever put a lemon or ice cube into your bottle of water, because that will change completely everything. You will dilute water with water. Sounds crazy, but it is like that.
You're not a fan of lemon lime water, that sort of thing?
I think like when people are saying like, but I love my water with a lime at one point. Yes, that makes sense. Okay, and do it. But when you want to try a new brand and you want to detect that brand new for you, do not do anything to that brand.
That's what we do with spirits too. Drink your drink how you want it. If you want to make a rum and coke, that's fine. But if I'm going to show you something unique and beautiful like this, experience it this way first. This is a very, very bold, intense spirit. And if you can... I normally leave it in my mouth and don't swallow for a good 10 to 15 seconds because it's so hot. You got to cut through that burn. But it's all honey and mission figs and fruits and brandies and rums. It's just...
What I think is always pretty cool, and this is the same what comes to water tasting sometimes, with the spirit too. In the beginning, you just have this burning effect. It's like, whoa. Oh my God, what's happening? You have the alcohol content right away in your nose and you have the alcohol content right away in your palate.
Coat your mouth.
Yeah. But when you swallowed it and you really rethink, and then you're like, you're almost discovering all the beauty suddenly out of the product, because this burning effect is now gone. It goes into your like down your throat. And now the aromas are actually appearing. Of that spirit. It's the same with wine, and sometimes the same with water. In the beginning with water, especially with the high TDS water, it's very intense. When you swallow that water, then actually the aromas are starting to appear. And it's not that easy always to detect that as a water sommelier, so sometimes even I have issues with that. And for me, when I have problems to really find the new nuances of that water, I start to shut down one of my other senses. So I'm trying to concentrate. I'm really trying to blend out everything what I'm hearing, or I'm closing my eyes sometimes even. I'm really concentrating off like, I just want now the flavor of that particular thing. And that helps.
It feels like it's infinitely more difficult to be a water sommelier than a spirits, because this is very bold. It's very in your face.
Oh yeah.
Very aggressive. I mean, it really punches you in the face. I am so in love with this spirit. But if you're not used to drinking it straight, it takes some acclimation for sure.
But this is the same with water. Now, the second zip what I had, now my palate already knew and was like, okay, there is something coming again. It's already way more mellower for me. It's not this,
yeah.
Oh my God, it's so spicy.
Your mouth is
so it's already acclimated to it. And now I think it's getting more and more interesting. So I think it's pretty cool. I like that.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I really like that.
Yeah, especially in Texas. Texas is still largely trying to figure out how to make great whiskey. There's a lot of them making some good whiskey, some making some okay whiskey. They're still trying to solve the Rubik's Cube, and we don't know if it's our water or if it's what it, or maybe the heat, the climate. We're not exactly sure. Yeah. Kentucky's got it figured out, and they love their water. But what's so funny about Kentucky is they rant and rave about the mineral content in their water, and they have a limestone shelf, but all of the water that goes into their spirits from all the major plants come from Louisville municipal tap water. So that's not to say it's not or that it's horrible tap water, but it's tap water. Yeah, like, yeah. You know, so.
And I think sometimes, let's face it, like everybody loves a great story. And when you're telling people, oh my God, it's all about our amazing spring water, what we're using, it sounds great in the beginning.
That's good sales pitch.
And nobody will hear the idea of, yeah, we're using municipal source water as a base product. It's like, everybody's like, what? It's like, really? Huh? And so no wonder like this crazy water companies, in my opinion, who's selling you filtered tap water, they don't want to disclose where the water is coming from, because nobody wants to hear that. So they're telling you, no, it's alkaline, it's high pH. Oh my God, this is so good for you. Obviously, it's all bullshit. Like, alkaline water is literally bullshit. It's like
explain that while we finish our pour here. You recently posted about that. There's a big push for alkali water. So what's your thoughts on that?
There's nothing wrong about alkaline water. Let's say it like that. There's nothing like harmful to alkaline water, drinking alkaline water. And for me as a water sommelier, high alkaline waters are quite interesting from a taste perspective sometimes, because they're very soapy in the palate. So it's quite of an interesting for me as a taste perspective. But when it comes to this whole health claims, then it gets a little bit trickier. And like the idea of like, okay, you can like, the idea of, okay, your body runs alkaline, therefore you should drink alkaline, or you need to drink high alkaline to balance out your acidic level of your body. First of all, your body is always alkaline. Like, your body is never acidic. And your body actually has different pH levels. Your stomach fluid needs to be acidic right there in that center, because you need to break down nutrients and food. When you will change that, you will die. You will die. You cannot survive on this planet when you cannot break down food anymore. So the claims to say I can drink alkaline water to balance the acidic levels out of my body is completely nonsense, obviously, because then when it would be true, you would balance out your acidic level of your stomach and you would pass. Your body, blood, runs 7.35 to 7.45, so it's slightly alkaline. It needs to be in that range. When it's not in that range, again, you will die after pretty much an hour. So therefore, again, the idea of I drink alkaline water because I can balance up my blood is completely nonsense.
It's nonsense.
Yes. When this would be true, you would not see the benefits, because you would be killed after an hour. When this would be actually true, that you can do something like that. Your lungs and your kidneys are responsible for your pH level, and they're doing an incredible good job to keep exactly the pH level what your body needs. So
it's just sales fluff.
Absolutely.
Anything on a bottle mentioning pH in alkali, or just
in general? Like, for me, like, for example, Ice and Glacier says here on the bottle, pH 8.4. So that means it's alkaline. But what they're saying, they don't say any health benefits to that. They're just saying it's pH 8.4. What is interesting for me as a sommelier? Okay.
This is just giving you information. Yeah.
It's giving you the information, but they don't say it cures cancer now. There are bottle companies who tell you that. There's one favorite one of my top five worst waters ever, Kangen water. I just had it again, and they're, for me, cult members. The people who believe in that whole scenario of Kangen, it's a machine, ionizing machine from Japan. For 40 years, they're selling it in a multi-level marketing scheme.
Okay.
Let's face that.
Right there is a dead giveaway.
That's already, you know, where already that business model is already over for me. So then you already know, like, it's a scam when you've been tried to be sold on this. When you're interacting with these people or you're posting something about Kangen, they go nuts on you, like literally nuts. It's quite fascinating. And sometimes I have to do it, because a lot of information, I'm doing it like on my social media, what I do, because I cannot respond to everybody who sends me an email or question. I receive a lot. So what I do, I look what the majority is asking for, and then I'm trying to do a post about that topic. So a lot of
that posts, way you kind of answer it.
And then I'm answering like broadly for a good percentage. So I saw in the last 2 weeks that a lot of people were suddenly telling me about Kangen water. Hey, Martin, what are your thoughts about Kangen? And even several people who own Kangen said to me, hey, Martin, you want to make money? You should support Kangen. And already that email's already for me like no go. I'm not a sommelier who wants to make money. We all need to make money, let's face it. But on my page, there's not even one link to say, please buy here, please buy that, something like this. I'm not doing this because that's not my business model. My business model is to educate people on the benefits of water. Yes, sometimes I'm partnering up with bottled water companies, but I'm really clearly said then as well on my social media, like I partnered up with brand A, B, or C, and then you will see it. Then you know why I'm doing this, but I have to believe in this first, in general. I would never ever partner up with a water brand I don't believe in. Like purified water brands try to give me really big checks to do postings for them, and I always decline this. I will not been bought off by anything like that. I will not do it. I would love to make money. And some people say, Martin, you're crazy. They would give you so much money. So I'm not interested in that. I really believe in my core of water should come from nature and there's benefits by drinking water. And in the long run, I think I can feel better about myself as well when I stick to my beliefs.
So you mentioned one of your top five. What are the other four worst waters? If you do have a list, a hit list of five for people to avoid.
I think Kangen is clearly up there because, again, just for the business model of the MLM. It's that. And then for the idea of, and I just had it again that somebody said, I can cure cancer with that. And this is for me so bad. Like, I think when you
dangerous.
Have. And I don't like to see people solicit. What is the word for it?
Solicit.
Soliciting on my Instagram account when it comes to water and cancer. That's for me, like, that's fake news.
Sure.
And I'm a very clear person. I don't like to delete comments, but this kind of things, these are claims for me. This has nothing to do anymore with scientific or realistic thinking. And I don't like to see this on my personal Instagram account.
It's dangerous.
Yes. Therefore, this thing has to go. Like, I don't, in a regular, I'm always like open-minded and I want to have the discussion. But when it comes to that, it's not going to happen with me. And I don't want these people on my page. They don't have anything to do there. And again, they're sending me all the time like pictures of their money checks, how much money they make on other people. I hate this. I'm really getting pissed off about that.
Yeah.
There's two other top brands, and I'm not shy to say them. It's Smartwater and it's Essentia. I'm not a fan of both companies for one big reason. And this has something to do because you said earlier Dasani. And Dasani is nothing else than actually purified municipal source tap water. And a lot of people hate Dasani for that. And a lot of people, when I put my top five worst water on this planet on my list, they said, but you missed Dasani. Saying the only thing why they're not on my top five is at least they don't fear their premium. So they don't mark themselves as a premium water. And they don't put any overhydrating or smart claims to it.
Yeah, they're not deceptive about it.
No, they're just saying, yes, we're Dasani, we're a purified water brand. They are like, they are actually truthful to their product.
The five brands you don't like are more out of their morals and their sales pitch.
Correct.
Life Water should be right next to Smart Water in the same.
Yeah, Life Water is for me, obviously, their whole sales pitch is, look, I have a fancy bottle, or I try to be fancy by putting different artists on it, and that's all what it is. Sorry, that's just laughable for me, that product.
Sure.
It's Pepsi. It's okay, whatever. It's fine with me. But this is my personal opinion. When you want to drink smart water and you want to spend Viper distilled, what is obviously nothing else than distilled.
Sure.
So it's boiled up water.
That's what distilled is. It's turning into vapor.
So
yeah.
Vapor distilled, like what a fancy word. And then they're saying electrolytes added. And this is like what then the problem is. Like Americans don't think about it then. And they're saying, oh, electrolytes added. Yeah, cool. They're adding electrolytes, so it has to be great. Yeah, but they don't tell you how many electrolytes they're adding. It's barely anything in there. LA Tap has 10 times more electrolytes dissolved than actually smart water.
What's the next adventure into water?
I think what we should do, because there are so many different brands here, I want something like, you hit me a little bit in the face with this.
Yeah.
Let's hit you in the face a little bit with some interesting waters.
Okay, all right.
So what I need to do, because again, I'm a lightheaded person.
You can dump. You're going to want to rinse too.
I'm not a big fan of dumping, obviously, an incredible good spirit. And this was for me really fascinating. So thank you so much for showcasing this
to
me.
Glad to experience with
you. I think this is something really cool and interesting. And whoever made that, a good job. It's approved by the water sommelier.
Yeah, nice.
Okay, so the next one, because now you gave me like something like in my head, almost like from the spirit perspective. So now I want to showcase something like very, very strong. And again, there's so many amazing brands here, like Iskilde from Denmark, Hallstein from Austria, Spicy Glenlivet from Scotland. So there's a lot of incredible good waters, but we obviously cannot revisit all the waters because
sure.
we would sit here till Christmas. Aqualife from Australia, and this is a water what we had on the Zac Efron show. I did not had it when I was with the mummies because I discovered that water later. So that's the cool thing about a water sommelier profession. I'm getting pretty much delivered another brand every week. So they all know now that I exist, and all these brands are reaching out to me and they're saying, hey, Martin, we have this and this water available. Are you interested to taste that? And I'm always eager to taste something new. It's for sure the same with you with spirits.
Sure.
You always want to be exposed to something new. That's the whole point why I love different cultures, because I love to eat a lot of different foods as
same,
well.
Same, yeah.
So
we talked
I love
about that last night at dinner.
I love to discover a culture through food. So Aqualife comes from Australia. That water is very, very unique. It has a TDS of 1,300. Very unusual for a still water. Very, very unusual. There are so many different minerals dissolved, key elements dissolved. It's quite fascinating. This is like a mix of Mother Nature, again, from Australia. You will see the difference right away.
So the first word that comes to mind is petrichor. Are you familiar with that term?
Uh-uh.
So petrichor is the smell of like if you're on a mountainside or you're hiking, you know, the rocks.
Okay.
After it rains, the mm-hmm. smell of wet earth, you're getting a lot of that earthy note. The layman term would be dirty. It smells dirty, but not in a bad way. It smells like wet stone. You know what I mean?
Yes. And I actually would have used the term dirty. Because I actually like that term.
Sure.
The taste even will be slightly like that. This earthy notes, the heaviness. It's almost like very thick on your palate. That is like Aqualife.
There's a finish there for sure. On the back end, after you swallow.
I think it's incredible water. It's a water what I can easily right away blind taste head out. I think when we would put ourselves now an Icelandic glacier, a Fiji, and Aqualife right next to each other in three glasses, I think we both could. Definitely the difference between Aqualife and other brands.
This one I could for sure.
Yeah, that's something very, very unique.
I may instinctually tell the difference with Fiji, but that's because I drink a lot of it.
But I like that. When it comes to pairing, Aqualife is a great, great, great water when it comes to spicy food. We're always saying like with spicy food and like water should be maybe not so much consumed because water will actually give even more spice to your palate. Aqualife is so thick and almost like this olive oil feeling. It's the same impact like milk. It's like it will balance out. It will pull the spiciness of food out and there's more aromas coming up. And I think this is a very unique product and I would love to showcase it to more American people. So now it feels like they finally have distribution all set up and hopefully next month they start to distribute to America. What I think would be great because America needs way more amazing spring waters, what you can actually buy in the store right now.
So in whiskey and spirits, there's a category that's either loved or hated called peat. Peated whiskey, and it's been determined that at some point the human palate is so sensitive to peat that it can taste it as small as 5 parts per million. Very, very small amount of peat should be discernible to the human palate. Have you figured out how low on the TDS scale before you can really taste the presence of dissolved solids?
It's quite interesting. You would think it goes like from zero TDS or BPM, what you said, parts per million. And then the higher the TDS goes, the more stronger will taste the water, obviously. We all know that. The thing is with water, especially when it comes to iceberg waters, like super low TDS, there's a range of your palate where it's like easy to drink. And it's like, yeah, it's water. It's like between like, I would guess between 50 and 200 TDS. That's like a normal, easy to drink like water, what everybody would think that's the taste of water. When it goes extremely low, it starts to get bitter and sometimes very dries out your mouth as well. And for me, I'm not a scientific person. I work in the restaurant business. I am for that. So for me and my belief is more like your body signalizes you something is off here. There's no more minerals dissolved, so it's kind of boring. It's kind of like a soup without salt. It's tasteless. Doesn't eager you to drink or eat more of that. It's the same with super, super low super, super low waters, like distilled water, for example, it really tastes terrible.
Right.
So your body kind of like signalizes you, don't drink that. It's not good. When it comes to extremely high again, then there's so much flavor going on, like a Gerolsteiner, a Vichykarlan, a Roy, what I have here right now for some of the two brands. There's so much going on. It's so intense. Then you clearly, and everybody can then taste the differences. But I think like between 50 and 200 TDS, that's like the range of like a normal drinking water where you would think that is water.
Yeah. So you're saying that on the low end is where you really notice a difference. And of course, on the high end, you notice Correct. It again. So I can distinctly tell the difference with that at about 1,000 TDS?
1,300 TDS, yeah.
Yeah, so clearly, that's very bold.
Oh yeah, that's bold.
And
the thickness.
What's the highest you've ever tasted?
28,000 TDS.
Was it? It had to be.
That's not enjoyable.
Yeah, it had to be a change of color, right?
Yeah,
that's it. It'd be gray or black.
No,
or?
it's actually white. It's water. It looks water to you in the beginning. It was from Romania. That water. It's a health water. It's a supplement. It's medicine. It's not hydration product anymore. Roy, for example, what we have, and we will definitely taste that. That is a water. They're even saying it on the homepage. It's not for hydration purposes. It's a dietary supplement. So some water is actually doing something to your body and not just hydration.
Sure.
And it's not actually healthy to drink this like in gallon-wise on a daily basis. There's so much magnesium or calcium or potassium dissolved that your body actually will not process this anymore. And then we can create kidney stones or something like that. So the residues of that extremely high concentration mineral can actually harm you as well over a long time of period. It's the same with medication. We all know an aspirin can be great. But when you're taking aspirin every day, every hour, that's very harmful to your body.
Yeah.
So it's the same with medicine, the same actually with water, with these extremely high TDS waters. When you're drinking today a Vichy, and I know a lot of people like Vichy, for example, has a TDS of 3,050, and I think we should drink this next. That is a high mineral water. 3,054 is high minerally. A lot of people always think, oh, Martin, all your fancy waters. Huh? All your fancy waters. This is the number one consumed water in Spain when it comes to carbonated water. So this is like the Arrowhead of Spain or the Poland Spring of Spain. So there's nothing fancy at all. You will find this water in every gas station in Spain. They're drinking this every day.
It's the Dasani of Spain.
Kind of, yeah, but like, I mean, like it's from the quality standpoint, it's something different. But
sure.
But yes, it's a
you very
can
common.
Easily, you can very come. It's like a Fiji. Like it's very common here in the States, Fiji water, and this is very common here in Spain.
Okay, so I'm so excited. And this is carbonated.
This is natural carbonated water, so that comes out of the spring like this, with their carbonation level on it. So natural carbonated spring-sourced water.
Got it, my whiskers. Spain. All right, let's do this. I'm excited. It smells like a pool.
It tastes like a pool. With all the chlorine, at least. But there's a high sodium content to this water. The TDS, again, 3,054. Here we go. Somebody's okay,
I have not had this.
It's intense.
I have not had this.
There's over 1,000 milligrams of sodium in that bottle. So
yes,
obviously
there is.
That is clearly the salty effect, what you have that. But I think it's not just salt. There's so many other things going on in this water, what I really enjoy. That is my barbecue water. I love that water with a nice barbecue, like a nice burger, a nice steak, something like that. What runs in high flavors, like
savory.
A lot of, like a, correct, like a lot of savory aromas to it. That is awesome because it's not so intense suddenly anymore when you're actually eating a sausage or something like this to it. And it can really hold up with that.
All right. So it's less salty the more you drink it,
mm-hmm.
but it first caught me off guard.
Oh, yeah. I think Conan O'Brien spit that water out.
He thought
like it's pool water, what I'm giving him there. Some people think it tastes like aspirin. Like it has
like a seltzer water.
It's a seltzer water. It's like very intense. And then with the ABC News anchor, I gave her some Spanish chorizo, like this paprika sausage. And she was eating that. And she's saying, now revisit that. And she's like, oh my God, that actually tastes really good now. And this is the impact of like how you're, but we talked about this in spirits earlier, like that the first sip was giving me like almost like the headache. And it's like, oh my God, that's so intense. But the second sip was already like pleaseful already. Like, oh my God, okay, now I'm getting it. Okay, there's more to discover. It's the same, like the palate is like run on heavy meat suddenly. So there's a lot of aromas. And now you're drinking Vichy. It's actually really cool because it will, and now I will almost say it will not really neutralize your palate, but it will cleanse your palate better. And more aromas can come up again because the fattiness of steak, we all know there's the heaviness of steak. There's carbonation to this water as well. It will actually help to digest. It will really like open up your palate again to eat again the burger. Versus imagine Aqualife to a steak. It's so thick and soapy. It will be too much. It will be like, oh my God, what the hell is this here? And that is the cool thing about these waters.
Yeah, so I like it. I officially like it. Why is it not available in the States?
Vichy is available now.
Oh, okay. I know it was on Aqua Maestro, but
It's not really like a water what you will find everywhere, but you can now here in Los Angeles, I think Erewhon, the grocery store has it. You can buy it on obviously on Aqua Maestro, but I think these kind of brands, these high TDS waters, and for sure, Crazy Water will tell you the same because I don't believe that Crazy Number 5, like one of the highest end water, will be the best-selling ones of their portfolio. For sure, they are like the smallest sales because the American palate just runs differently. They think water should be neutral and tasteless. Even Wikipedia says water is tasteless, but clearly it's not.
Right.
So I think that is the reason why this high carbonated waters with a lot of TDS are a little bit offsetting for a lot of Americans because they don't used to this. When they're getting used to it, they're like, oh, actually, it's actually tasty. But don't think in your brain right away of, oh, it's water, what I on regular basis drink from a water pitcher. That's not it.
No, definitely not.
That tastes definitely differently.
Definitely not.
Cool. One more thing, huh?
All right, so this thing here.
This is something very special. This is a water you cannot actually purchase in America at all. And I'm the only one here in America who has access to this water.
Oh, look at this.
So we both are the only people right now here in America who actually can drink this.
Okay.
Nobody else will drink this. This is a water brand from Slovenia. It's called Roy Chukrin. It's a very, very old brand, actually. It used to be the second most sold carbonated water on this planet.
What happened?
You will see what happened.
Okay. I feel like it's exciting. What does that run?
About 50 euros per bottle.
50 bucks a bottle?
Yeah. So it's pricey. Intense. It's pricey. It's pricey. And when we're talking about water and price, yes, I totally understand for people who will say like, that's nuts. Like 50 euros for a bottle of water, you completely are crazy now over here. And yes, for daily hydration, that would be completely nuts and crazy. But think about two ways. First of all, water is relative for a lot of people. Like, some people are going to McDonald's and buying themselves the kids' meal for like $2 or $3. I don't even know how expensive that is. And this is a lot of money what they're actually investing by the base on the money what they're actually earning. And some other people like billionaires, they're going to a Michelin star restaurant. They're spending thousands of dollars. That might be cheaper for them to go there than for the person goes to McDonald's. So money is relative for a lot of people. So
sure.
We should all understand that. And then when we have like water companies who are selling you municipal sourced water, obviously the production cost is totally different than a water brand like this where they're producing, I don't know how many thousands of bottles.
Oh my God, I just saw.
Yeah, there's something in there.
There's some pulp.
There's something
in there.
Floating in there,
you
huh?
See that
like
in there?
That happens when
you moved. I saw the snow globe.
When the mineral composition is so high that actually this starts to it starts to settle down on the bottle.
Oh, that's so exciting.
When I'm opening this bottle, you will see a chemical reaction. Actually.
Oh, really? Yeah. So for those of my listeners who don't know, 50 euros is about 55 to 60 bucks American.
Shall we play the prices right? Shall we first taste it and then you will guess the TDS?
That sounds good. Let's do that. I'm excited.
But you see, like for the listeners to us and you don't see us on YouTube. So I opened this water. It looked like a normal water brand to you. Now you open it and now it's bubbling. It's like it's bubbling, bubbling, bubbling,
it's
bubbling,
not stopping.
Bubbling. It's not stopping.
So like when you open a can of Coke or a bottle of Sprite, it briefly bubbles and then settles. This is not settling. It's,
correct.
It's fully active.
It's fully active. And this is the same impact when I'm starting to pour now a little bit into
it. How close is Slovenia to Chernobyl? Just curious.
Don't worry about that. It looks like a soda when I'm pouring it.
Yes, it does. It sounds like a soda.
The smell is already crazy.
I'm gonna put it in my dumb, because I'm not experienced at this. So the first thing that comes to mind.
So water can have an odor.
It's drainage water.
And that's, yeah.
Like
yeah,
kind
yeah.
of a,
it has this slightly sulfur like smell to it too.
So it's like the petrichor thing, but like the puddle of water on the rock that's been sitting there all day. It's got kind of a, people are like, why are you drinking this? It sounds awful. All right, let me taste it here.
The taste is just crazy.
That is a lot of water. Oh, and even after you swallow it, it's really there.
It stays. It stays.
Yeah,
it lingers so long on your palate. This is the highest magnesium-rich water ever been found on this planet.
7,000.
You're very close. You're very close. Okay. 7,400 TDS. Wow. It has like, yes, you have the saltiness, the complexity of Vichy, but it has this almost like chewing on a penny effect, like this metallic notes are really coming up here. And that is the magnesium, actually, your palate is now pulling up in that water too.
It's really intense.
Yeah, it is intense. This is not a water I would pair for. That is a water, what you just did with me with the spirit. That's a water for me. I'm putting a little bit in a glass and I'm just smelling and zipping on it.
Yeah, so it's not
it's not a hydration product.
It's not gross. I mean, I've had more offensive spirits. It's just so unique and such a, it's like turning water up to 11. It's really intense. And when you put it in your mouth, the carbonation, it's still going. It's still bubbling.
I told you earlier that used to be the second most selling sparkling water on this planet. And you ask me like, so what happened? So first of all, I think like the taste profile is like, whew, that's intense. Do you even know who came up with the idea of bottled water? Like who started that thing? That you like that putting water in like a small bottle and selling it.
European thing?
Yeah, it's a European thing. And we still have that thing going on in Europe. The thing was that obviously we all know that for hydration purposes, people, the Romans, everybody was already like taking water in like bigger vessels to take them in the army, all this kind of stuff, because they wanted to make sure they were hydrating. So they already knew for many, many years ago that hydration is important. But the idea of smaller vessels, and I have one right in front of here. This used to be bottled water. This is where bottled water looks like for 120 years ago, pretty much. This is a 120-year-old water bottle. It's from Selters. That's actually a German brand. This used to be bottled water. And where's your little plastic bottle there? So this turned into this. And I think that's already a sad part to see that, because this was loaded with minerals for one purposes. That was not for hydration. That was for medicine. And we have a lot of bath and spa towns still all over Europe where people are going by the recommendation of their doctors. So we're not talking about like some crazy people who are telling like, oh, you should drink that water and then you cure your cancer. We already discussed that. No, there's actually scientific proof of some water brands that they have an impact on your body due to the fact of the mineral compositions of that particular brand. So therefore, this whole spa and bath towns were created. People went there. And when the people were too sick to go to the spa town people said, okay, now we need to send the water, the healing powers of these waters to the sick people. And pretty much medication was invented. So bottled water in this purposes started as medication. We still have, and a lot of people maybe will, oh, I just had actually a nutrition girl calling me out in an interview to say, no, Martin said there's medicinal water. This is so wrong what he's saying, because this is not true. Go to Germany. There's a whole regulation of medicinal waters. They have medication codes even on the bottles. It's not for hydration. That is actually medicine required by the medicine law. And yes, there are medicine waters out there on this planet, because you're from America and you never maybe knew that concept does not mean that I'm giving you fake news. So just open your eyes a little bit, look at other countries about regulations, and you suddenly realize, oh my God, there's more. So Roy, for example, that is not for hydration. That is actually medicine. the magnesium content is so high on that water that it has an impact on your body.
And why is it not available in the history there? You said that it, at one point in time it was...
Because it used to be medication, but medication was invented now. We know as medication in pills and syrups and all this kind of things that we are like buying it now from the pharmacy. But back in the days, the pharmacy sold you this.
Gotcha.
And this was already a recycled bottle. So pretty cool that 20 years ago, they already thought about recycling this. So it's not like that they sent it back to the water companies. No, they destroyed this and built it streets. So a lot of streets in Europe, when they're digging up now, old streets, they will find old water bottles.
That's awesome. Thank you so much for doing this. I'd love to shake your hand, but the whole world's on fire. So
hey, I'm a water sommelier. Maybe I can dilute this fire, hopefully, at one point. Huh?
Well, thanks again. Thanks so much for everything. Thank you, of course, to the hotel. This has just been fantastic. And keep your jeans high and tight.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And I'm always saying to the end of my podcast, drink good water because we need to hydrate ourselves and don't drink anything from a factory.
Absolutely. Cheers. Is there anything else you want to mention before we go? You want to plug your podcast?
One thing, what's very important to me, it is a privilege to drink bottled water. And this is something what actually is very concerning to me. There's millions of people on this planet who don't even have access to clean and safe drinking water. So we should be very, very lucky and thankful that we are able to drink bottled water and that we have this ability to even drink and pair different waters to amazing spirits. But we should always think and be thankful about it and maybe help people who don't have access to clean and safe drinking water. I'm supporting Viva Con Aqua. It's a nonprofit organization out of Germany, and they're building spring sources right there where people don't have water. So they don't give money to a government. They're actually doing it by themselves. They're going into the countries and building springs. And I think this is something what I love to support.
Sweet.
Yeah, that's Cheers. Important.
Thanks,
me.
Guys.
Cheers.
Balcony's first ever year-round bourbon was an inspiration. It all had to work together. A blend of carefully selected ingredients, Texas-sized pot stills, and creative people determined to find the absolute best way to usher a new whiskey along. When you discover how it pairs with a meaningful moment, suddenly the feeling of drinking great whiskey becomes a whole lot more.